name, inshallah, is called Fathul Bari. Fathul Bari. Fathul Bari. The contribution of this scholar, the contribution is Al-Hafiz Ibn Hajar Al-Asqalani. The complete name, is Al-Hafiz Ibn Hajar Al-Asqalani. نعم طيب الحمد لله no problem إن شاء الله his name is Al-Hafiz Ibn Hajar Al-Asqalani one of the renowned scholars of Islam it is really important yes it's really important a remembrance of these great scholars of Islam and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for their mercy for his mercy upon them and for his forgiveness as well and this is very privilege to know of the great scholars of Islam this would be something very important in their strive to learn the deen because these are examples and in their strive there is great or great lessons rather to learn there about Al-Hafiz Ibn Hajar today and his contribution or the contribution of this scholar to the knowledge of the Sunnah renders his work indispensable for the seeker of the knowledge and in his story there is a good example of the honesty and sincerity of the scholars in conveying the da'wah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As I said, his name is Abu al-Fadl Ahmad ibn Ali bin Muhammad al-Kinani, better known as al-Hafiz ibn Hajar al-Asqalani. And he is a hafiz, meaning master of hadith of his era. He was born on the 12th of Sha'ban of the year 773 of Hijrah in Egypt, where after the death of his mother, he was given a he memorized the Quran when he was 9 years of age and he took the studies of very important books Al-Umda, Al-Hawi, Mukhtasar and other books his learning started with Al-Umda under the scholar of Al-Jamal ibn al-Zahira in Mecca After another scholar in Cairo by the name of As-Sadr al-Ibsiti he later at the age of 17 continued his studies under Al-Shams ibn al-Qattan He learned fiqh from him and Arabic. And he studied Al-Hawi. He also took fiqh lectures from scholars like Al-Anbasi, Al-Balqini, and Ibn al-Mulaq. He studied upon them all. Under the scholarship of Al-Izz ibn Jama'a in the year he rounded off many branches of knowledge under the scholar Al-Izz ibn Jama'a in the year 790 of Hijrah until Al-Jama'a's death in 18 of Hijrah He continued the study of Arabic under the renowned Al-Fayruz Al-Fayrouz Abadi, the compiler of Al-Qamus, compiler of Umus. And he learned the recitation of the Quran from Al-Burhan Al-Tannuqi. From the beginning, Al-Hadith was much interested in Hadith. And he began seeking that knowledge in the year 793 of Hijra. Effort culminated in seeking it in the year 796 after Hijra. In fact, he wrote about this. He said, quote, "The curtain was raised and the gate opened." He continued to strive in learning the hadith, and he was rightly guided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this matter. He authorities of his subject, or of the subject of hadith rather, in that era of his. For 10 years he was a student of Al-Izz Hussain al-Iraqi, who read to him from his own works and from whom he benefited a great deal. He then traveled to Al-Sham in Arabia, the western part of Arabia, whereby he was afforded a rare opportunity to study under the best scholars of his time. And his masters licensed him to teach and give decrees. This allowed him to take the responsibility of spreading the knowledge of hadith. He spent most of his time reading, teaching, and compiling it. That's why most of his publications were mainly in hadith, and they numbered more than 150. And all of them were eagerly and happily accepted, especially this great called Fath al-Bari, which is the explanation of Sahih al-Bukhari. In fact, students, scholars, colleagues, 150 books colleagues, scholars, students, all anxiously collected his works, which were and they used it to teach others. He requested from Allah the guidance to comment on Sahih al-Bukhari, which is considered the most authentic book after the book of Allah. If we read the introduction that he put in his explanation of Sahih al-Bukhari, which is called Fath al-Bari, we read Al-Hafiz saying the following: "The most worthy subject on which the devotion and most honorable to which devotion was given was dealing with Al-Ulum al-Shar'iyya, the sciences of the revelation, which was received from the best brought forth creature Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And many sciences are based on the book of Allah and the sunnah of his selected prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. All other sciences are either tools to understand them, and these are the desirable ones, or forbidden and non-profitable ones. I have seen the Imam al-Bukhari in his Al-Jami' al-Sahih, which is Sahih al-Bukhari, stood up to enlighten himself of the Quran and the Sunnah, meaning by the process of affirmation and deduction. He deeply extracted his knowledge from these sources. He gained happiness for what he collected because of his good intention." He is referring to whom? He is referring to Sahih al-Bukhari. he deeply, meaning Imam al-Bukhari, he deeply extracted his knowledge from these sources, and he gained happiness for what he collected because of his good intention. Agreed and disagreed with him, yielded to his authority. Hence I requested guidance. Listen to this. Hence I requested guidance from Allah to supplement Sahih al-Bukhari with comments, clarify its objectives, and unveil its aim. End of quote. So Al-Hafidh Ibn Hajar's work was extensive and took him 14 large volumes to fulfill his promise. In the time of Al-Hafidh Ibn Hajar, the spirit for the assimilation of the detailed text of hadith was in decline, and concise collection of decrees verifying and indicating the rank of a hadith as to its authenticity, weakness or defectiveness, and indicated who extracted it in the original source, the roots of most of the hadith, and corrected any addendum pertaining to their status. His book now was divided by topic and included the most authentic hadith while excluding whatever the others. He did, however, use some less reliable hadith as examples under the condition that the weakness was not so grave. All of this work, he collected it in بلوغ أدلة الأحكام, بلوغ المرام من أدلة الأحكام, attaining the aim of the proofs of the decrees. Attaining, عليكم السلام ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. Attaining the aim of the proofs of the decrees. A very few hadith that are related to the أحكام, related to the rulings in Islam. And it is translated into English and it's available in the English library. This book is very and extremely beneficial for all Muslims. And our Shaykh, Shaykh Muhammad bin Salih al-Uthaymeen, may Allah's mercy be upon him, expounded on this book and explained it in so many times. He explained this book, rahimahullah, and the benefits in it is something beneficial. And now alhamdulillah it's coming up in print in its most revised form, and it inshallah will be out in any time inshallah. The people of knowledge paid great attention to the book by Al-Hafidh bin Hajar, which I'm talking about, which is Bulugh al-Maram, attaining the aim of the proofs and the degrees. They did this in the past and continue to do it today. Also, Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah had an explanation and sharh for Bulugh al-Maram. And some of it now is being transcribed, alhamdulillah. But in the hands of the students of knowledge, you can find a lot of the explanations. The inscription of Al-Hafidh's book was common in the press, and as attested to by its appearance in the libraries of most of the scholars. The book was then first printed in The book was first printed in India with a concise commentary by Al-Amir As-Sam'ani, which is known as Subul As-Salam. This is a commentary on سنته ثم بلوغ المرام. His justice. Although he was also a just judge, Ibn Hajar decided not to get involved with such work. However, after the Sultan al-Judge on a personal case, another judge by the name of Jalaluddin al-Balqini insisted that he sit on other cases. After subsequent cases, he was offered the position of the great judge or great judgeship in Egypt. He assumed this responsibility on the 12th of Muharram in the year 827. He regretted the acceptance of this position because the state leaders did not appreciate his honesty and they excessively blamed him for rejecting from the truth. They went so far as to declare him an enemy. Ibn Hajar had them to be wary of all subtle details and could not judge according to what he believed to be just himself by accepting their matters to rule on. He was removed from the office on the 7th or the 8th of the Qa'dah of the same year, 827 after Hijrah. He was soon recalled on the 2nd of the next year, to the delight of the people who truly loved him. His authority was expanded to include not only Egypt, but also the countries of Asham, the greater Syria. He continued in this position until in Safar of the year 833 of Hijrah, after Hijrah. His career was marked by a constant flux in and out of office. He was recalled at the first of the year 834 after Hijrah and held office this time until the year of 840 after Hijrah. To make it short, his final position as a judge came in the year 852 and lasted 72 days. Thereafter, he refused to resume activity as a judge to the youth accompanying his position. It was to be mentioned here that it was only due to the piety and the fear of Allah that he adhered to so strictly to the truth as basis reason he was harassed by those seeking to circumvent Allah's legislation. And here it's worth mentioning a story that took place between a Jew who was olive oil. So his business was in oil, and you know, working with oil, what it makes of your clothes and stuff, of how you appear. So he saw the caravan bringing him to the court, you know, when he was a judge. And he saw all these people coming, you know, paving the way for Al-Hafiz to enter and accompanying Al-Hafiz Ibn Hajar. This Jew heard of the hadith of the saying of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Ad-dunya jannatul mu'min, ad-dunya sijnul mu'min wa jannatul kafir." The third is the jail of the believer, and it is paradise for the disbeliever. The Jew heard this. And the Jew was looking about his miserable clothing and the, you know, the suffering he was in. Okay, brother Perkus, let it go inshallah. We'll see how it will go inshallah. Jazakallah khair. So he came to Al-Hafidh one day and he said, Your Honor, I have a question. Your Prophet says that this life for the kafir is paradise. And look at me. Is this paradise for me? Look at the way I am, look. The hardship I am in. And look at you, caravan, a judge. What else you need? So Al-Hafidh answered, the hardship that you are in this life, is paradise compared to what else if you die on a state of disbelief. This is paradise compared to what you will see in the hereafter if you die on a state of disbelief. And as to the favors of Allah upon me is nothing compared to what awaits the believer in the hereafter from the endless bliss if he dies on it. The Jew, when he heard this explanation, immediately declared, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. I bear witness that there is no true God worthy of worship except Allah, and that Muhammad is the Messenger who accepted Islam. As well as being a judge, Ibn Hajar spent more than 21 years as a lecturer and teacher in all of the Qahira, Cairo, including many masajid, many mosques and schools. In fact, he was the supervisor and the leader of the by and he is also permitted to give decrees in Dar al-Adl, the House of Justice, and speak at both Al-Azhar and Masjid Umar, the Mosque of Umar. This was indeed a unique honor. In fact, he was known, alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh, to have lectured his work by recitation from his sharp memory at almost 1,000 separate occasions. He used to travel far distances to seek the knowledge, including reaching the leaders of the various schools of thought. State of memorization, trustworthiness, sharp mind, outstanding intelligence, great knowledge. Al-Hafidh Al-Iraqi, a renowned scholar of Hadith of the Sahih, testified that Ibn Hajar Al-Asqalani, our scholar that we're talking about today, was the most knowledgeable in Hadith amongst all of his colleagues. In fact, I remember a saying of Muhammad, he said, لم تلد النساء إلى الآن مثل الحافظ ابن حجر. Women didn't give birth to men like Al-Hafidh ibn Hajar until our time. Ibn Hajar suffered from diarrhea and bleeding on the 28th of Dhul Hijjah in the year 852 after Hijrah. Imam al-Suyuti commented saying, quote, the door was closed after him and this matter of hadith of knowledge was sealed by him, meaning because of his great contribution. Hadith, the Sultan, meaning the leader in Egypt, carried the bier and attended the Salah, the prayer, the funeral prayer, which was led by Al-Imam Al-Baqillani, rather by Al-Imam Al-Balqini, I'm sorry. He was buried next to the grave of Imam Al-Shafi'i, one of al-Imam al-Layth bin Sa'd. Al-Layth bin Sa'd, a great student of al-Imam al-Shafi'i and a great scholar of hadith as well. May Allah's mercy be upon al-Hafidh ibn Hajar. His commentary on Sahih al-Bukhari, al-Bari, Fath al-Bari, Fath, opening means. Al-Bari is the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's one of the names of Allah, al-Bari. That's why the scholars, they have a comment, they're saying, لا هجرة بعد الفتح, meaning there is no migration after الفتح, after the book, meaning يعني, no one could ever write something as splendid as the commentary by Al-Hafidh Ibn Hajar on Sahih al-Bukhari. And it's an inspiration during the time of Al-Hafidh and in our times as well. As you know, scholars are men also. And scholars also look, because they are not infallible. But when a scholar exerts the effort sincerely and is known to be a scholar, then he is in a state. Meaning striving. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if he errs, Allah will reward him one reward. Al-Hafidh bin Ajar, bin Hajar rahimahullah, aspects of our creed, mainly the names and attributes of Allah. He had some significant in Tawfiq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this was, as you know, this was mostly of the Ash'arite school, which influenced so much of the Muslim world and still influencing the world with respect to this matter, and that is the resort to figurative interpretation of some of the attributes of Allah. But this was his understanding. When you find Fath al-Bari, you will find certain corrections in the footnotes. So when you read it, make note of that, because these were corrected, alhamdulillah, and commented on them in the footnotes as to their true creed regarding the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah the Most High have mercy upon Al-Hafidh ibn Hajar. Allah may forgive him and forgive all the scholars of Islam. Sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.